Everybody at church, how are y'all doing? So I had a few requests for the story on Sunday that I told. This is a story by Elizabeth Ballard. I don't know the official name is Teddy Stoddard, but you can definitely look that up by that name. I'll also put it in the BAM as well. And the BAM, if you guys don't know, if you're just visiting here on Facebook, you can go out to our homepage, beatitudeschurch.org, and you can sign up for the e-newsletter if you'd like. It comes every week, and we have lots of different things in there, lots of things that are happening, events, things like that. And we also have calendars. We have the different things that our church decides they give to different organizations like Maryland School. That's going to be coming up here pretty soon. And ICM and Bishop's Pantry and things like that. So there's lots of ways that you can plug in to the church, and then there are also some volunteer opportunities on that too. So that's on the BAM, and that's our e-newsletter, and you can go online and sign up for that, beatitudeschurch.org. Okay, good. So we're just going to settle in, take a nice breath, relax, just let the story connect with your heart. There's a story many years ago of an elementary teacher. Her name was Mrs. Thompson. And as she stood in front of her fifth grade class on the very first day of school, she told the children a lie. Like most teachers, she looked at her students and said that she loved them all the same. But that was impossible, because there in the front row, slumped in his seat, was a little boy named Teddy Stoddard. Mrs. Thompson had watched Teddy the year before and noticed that he didn't play well with the other children, that his clothes were messy, and that he constantly needed a bath, and Teddy could be unpleasant. It got to the point where Mrs. Thompson would actually take delight in marking his papers with a broad red pen, marking bold X's, and then putting a big F at the top of his papers. At the school where Mrs. Thompson taught, she was required to review each child's past records, and she put Teddy's off until last. However, when she reviewed his file, she was in for a surprise. Teddy's first grade teacher wrote, "Teddy's a bright child with a ready laugh. He does his work neatly and has good manners. He is a joy to be around." His second grade teacher wrote, "Teddy is an excellent student, well-liked by his classmates, but is troubled because his mother has a terminal illness and life at home must be a struggle." His third grade teacher wrote, "His mother's death has been hard on him. He tries to do his best, but his father doesn't show much interest, and his home life will soon affect him if some steps aren't taken." Teddy's fourth grade teacher wrote, "Teddy is withdrawn and doesn't show much interest in school. He doesn't have many friends and sometimes sleeps in class." By now, Mrs. Thompson realized the problem, and she was ashamed of herself. She felt even worse when her students brought her Christmas presents wrapped in beautiful ribbons and bright paper, except for Teddy's. His present was clumsily wrapped in the heavy brown paper that he got from a grocery bag. Mrs. Thompson took pains to open it in the middle of the other presents. Some of the children started to laugh when she found a rhinestone bracelet with some of the stones missing and a bottle that was one quarter full of perfume. But she stifled the children's laughter when she exclaimed how pretty the bracelet was, putting it on and dabbing some of the perfume on her wrist. Teddy Stoddard stayed after school that day just long enough to say, "Mrs. Thompson, today you smell just like my mom used to." After the children left, she cried for at least an hour. On that very day, she quit teaching reading and writing and arithmetic. Instead, she began to teach children. Mrs. Thompson paid particular attention to Teddy. As she worked with him, his mind seemed to come alive. The more she encouraged him, the faster he responded. By the end of the year, Teddy had become one of the smartest children in the class, and despite her lie that she would love all the children the same, Teddy became one of her teacher's pets. A year later, she found a note under her door from Teddy telling her that she was still the best teacher he'd ever had in his whole life. 6 years went by before she got another note from Teddy. He then wrote that he'd finished high school, third in his class, and she was still the best teacher he ever had in his whole life. 4 years after that, she got another letter saying that While things had been tough at times, he'd stayed in school, had stuck with it, and would soon graduate from college with the highest of honors. He assured Mrs. Thompson that she was still the best and favorite teacher he'd ever had in his whole life. 4 more years passed, and yet another letter came. This time he explained that after he got his bachelor's degree, he decided to go a little further. The letter explained that she was still the best and favorite teacher he'd ever had, but now his name was a little longer. The letter was signed Theodore F. Stoddard, M.D. The story doesn't end there, you see. There was yet another letter that spring. Teddy said he'd met this girl and was going to be married. He explained that his father had died a couple years ago, and he was wondering if Mrs. Thompson might agree to sit in the place at the wedding that was usually reserved for the mother of the groom. Of course Mrs. Thompson did, and guess what? She wore that bracelet, the one with several rhinestones missing. And she made sure she was wearing the perfume that Teddy'd remember his mother wearing on their last Christmas together. They hugged each other, and Dr. Stoddard whispered in Mrs. Thompson's ear, "Thank you, Mrs. Thompson, for believing in me. Thank you so much for making me feel important and showing me that I could make a difference." Mrs. Thompson, with tears in her eyes, whispered back. She said, "Teddy, you have it all wrong. You were the one who taught me that I could make a difference. I didn't know how to teach until I met you." I don't know if anybody else is crying, but I'm crying. I have heard and read this story so many times, and I still get teary. Why does it bother me? It's that love, it's that amazing appreciation and tenderness and kindness and sweetness of simple acts, you know? And I would also invite you that as we take a moment to just breathe and rest and be with this idea and these ideas, I'm going to invite you to just think of all of the times that you made a difference in someone's life. It could be something really small. I mean, how hard is it to put perfume on? You know, I mean, just little teeny things that we can do that make a massive difference. And we don't even know that we're doing them sometimes. But perhaps there's something that you can recall in your own life where you could say, I think that helped someone. And then also looking at the times that someone did that for you as well, which is really powerful. So enjoy your day. Be with this day. Know that you're loved beyond measure. Know that God loves you and is with you. And, you know, this is just a fun, fun thing to just experience and to know for yourself as well. Take care. I hope you enjoy your day. Make that difference and allow that difference to come to you as well. Love you all. Bye.